Stephen Burrows, Superboy, smartest kid in the neighborhood. Stephen Burrows, Superboy, uses his magic powers for good. Super eyes, super ears, super nose. Whenever there's trouble, Stephen knows. Stephen Burrows, Stephen Burrows, Superboy.
It was another boring Sunday afternoon. Stephen Burrows was at home. His mum was busy clearing up the kitchen after lunch. His brother was cleaning his car, again, and his gran was dozing on the sofa. Stephen could think of nothing he wanted to do. He wandered into the garden and began poking at a line of ants with a stick. That's it! He'd build a dinosaur landscape with the new dinosaurs he bought at the car boot sale that morning. He could build a dinosaur cave above where the ants were coming from. It would make it more realistic.
Mum, where's the stuff I bought this morning? I want to play with the dinosaurs.
The bags are in the hall. I didn't have time to unpack them before lunch. Bring me the rest through here, will you? I want to get them out of the way. And please don't dig up the bulbs I've just planted if you're going to make another dinosaur nest.
No, Mum.
Stephen, like many seven-year-old boys, had a large collection of plastic dinosaurs. They were all sizes, all types, and mostly he kept them in the garden. He felt they'd be happier there. Mum just got a bit irritated when they kept getting caught up in the lawnmower, or when Stephen got carried away creating a particularly realistic landscape and in the process dug up one of her precious plants. He looked through the plastic carrier bag that he'd acquired earlier that morning.
Brilliant! 3 plesiosaurs and a new pterodon. Just what I need. And this stick can be the new head of the herd, as he's the biggest.
Rawr, 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 rawr.
The new dinosaurs did the trick, and it was tea time before Stephen knew it.
Will you come in and wash your hands, please, Stephen? And tell Dominic it's tea time, will you?
Yes, Mum.
Oh, I nearly forgot. Stephen, I've put a book on your bed that Gran bought for you at the car boot. It's about spelling, I think. There's one for you, Dominic. Some car manual or something.
Lovely gentleman with a bookstall. You know him, dear. The one with the beard and the eye-catching hat. He's there most weeks. He'd got the whole collection of Georgette Hare and some lovely, lovely old books. I know how you boys enjoy reading.
Thanks, Gran.
When he finished his tea and played 3 games of Power Rangers with Dominic, Stephen had a bath and got into bed to read. He might as well have a quick look at that tatty old book that Gran had bought. He loved reading, but it was true that he really was terrible when it came to spelling. The book looked really old. It had one of those thick brown covers where the letters were sunk in a bit. It was quite big too, and heavy. The pages made a thick golden edge when the book was closed. It had lots of letters on the front, practically the whole alphabet, and because some of them were worn, it was quite hard to make out the name of the book.
The A to Z of spell. Maybe it's the A to Z of spelling. I can't read it properly. Cowabunga! It's the A to Z of spells. Grant's bought me a book of spells by mistake. A real old book of spells. She's even written inside, 2SB from MB. Keep practicing. Strange. But then she does know I need help with my spelling. I can't believe it. This book's just magic.
Stephen sat up in bed and slowly started turning the stiff old pages of the book. It really was amazing. All the words looked like they had been written by hand in an old ink pen. Stephen had seen someone using one once at a craft fair. And there were pictures, more like paintings on many of the pages, Strange pictures of people doing amazing things like jumping over trees and running beside galloping horses. It was fascinating. The writing meant that a lot of it was quite hard to read. He could just about make out a few words.
Wow! Wait till I show Callum this. It's just so cool. Hang on. Here's one I can read. Now, what does it say? A super spell to begin with. Can't do any harm just to read through, can it? At the initial of the serpent and the letter like 8, 4 ancient powers just will not wait. Used for good, only must they be, for else they'll be taken away from ye. Doesn't make any sense at all to me.
Stephen, it's time to put your light out. I'll be up in a minute to check.
Yes, Mum. Night, Mum.
When Stephen woke up the next morning, he remembered straight away that it was a school day, but he'd completely forgotten about the strange spell book. He turned over in bed and started to think about the things that happened on a Monday and the news that he had to tell his friends. Then he heard his mum's voice and assumed she'd come to tell him to get up and clean his teeth.
Milk. Here you go, love. Oh, I'm so glad the weather's cheered up a bit. Makes Mondays all the more bearable, doesn't it?
Mum?
Now where's Stephen, I wonder? He should be dressed by now. If I'm not careful, he's going to be late for school.
That's amazing! I can hear Mum talking in the kitchen, as if she was right here. I can smell bacon too. Lovely.
Stephen! Oh, you should be dressed by now, love. Come on, please, or we'll be late for school.
Okay, Mum, I'm up. Bacon smells brilliant, by the way. What a treat.
What bacon?
I can smell bacon cooking. Really looking forward to a bacon sandwich for breakfast.
But there isn't any bacon, love. It's cereal as normal. Are you sure you're feeling all right?
Yes, Mum. I was sure I could smell bacon cooking downstairs. I'll just go and do my teeth. I can smell bacon and brown sauce, and I can hear stuff. Oh dear, I can hear Mrs. Evans next door. I hope she's not coming round. She's saying goodbye to Mr. Evans, and he's saying what a lovely bacon sandwich it was. Oh no! I can't believe it. They're not coming round at all. I'm hearing them in their front hall. That's amazing. It's like I've suddenly got extra good hearing and an extra sensitive nose. What is going on?
Stephen was still puzzled when he arrived at school. Something had definitely happened to his hearing. When he concentrated, he could hear what people were saying when they walked past outside his classroom, even when the door was shut. And he could hear exactly what Tamsin and Megan were whispering about, even though they sat on the table furthest away from him and Callum. There was something going on with his nose too. He could tell that Callum had ham sandwiches in his lunchbox and that Mrs. Hall had a tuna roll in her desk drawer. By break time, he was getting worried.
Callum, I think something's happened to my ears.
What? Your ears? They look the same to me. Normal, Want a quick game of golden goals?
No, you don't understand. It's not what my ears look like, it's what they can do. I can hear stuff from way off, through walls and stuff.
What?
Look, I'll show you. Go to the other side of the field and tell Adam something. It doesn't matter what, just make sure I can't guess. Then come back and I'll tell you what it was you said.
You've gone crazy, but if it means we can get on with the game, I'll do it. Okay, Crazy. Tell me you heard what I said.
Easy, because I did. You said Stephen told Megan you wanted to be her boyfriend, which isn't true, by the way.
That's amazing! There's no way you could have guessed that I said that. How did you do it? When did you find out? What else can you do?
Stephen told Callum about his super strength hearing and his amazing powers of smell. By the end of that break time, they'd also worked out that he'd got incredible powers of sight, which meant that he could see things clearly far, far away, like if you were looking through a really powerful telescope. It meant that Stephen could read what was written on the notes that the girls were passing around. It annoyed Callum that he refused to tell him what he could see. When asked, he just went a bit pink. They also worked out that suddenly Stephen had become very, very strong. They'd noticed when they'd first gone onto the pitch that one goalpost was slightly out of line. Callum was looking around for some other boys to help them push it back when Stephen moved the whole thing back by himself. Then, because they couldn't quite believe it was true, Stephen tested his new super strength by straightening out the top bar of the goalpost with just his hands. It had been bent ever since Geordie's big brother had climbed up and sat on it after last summer's school disco.
What's happened to you? It's like you've suddenly got special powers. This is amazing, Stephen. It will be just great. We can get whatever we want now. Just think, you can win all the races at Sports Day, see all the answers in the test, hear all the girls' secrets, smell what's for tea before you go in, so you can come round to mine if you don't like it.
I don't think it's about that. Really, I don't. Callum, I've got a feeling that I can do these things for a reason. Listen, you won't tell anyone, will you?
When school had finished for the day, the two boys walked home together knocking nettles with sticks. They couldn't work out what Stephen's special powers meant, or how he could use them.
I mean, why you? What happened to give you these powers anyway? Surely you can't have just woken up like this for no reason at all. Are you sure nothing happened at the weekend?
No, nothing at all. It was really boring. Dom was fiddling around cleaning his car and wouldn't let me near it. Gran read her books and Mum did jobs as usual. The only thing we did was on Sunday morning when we went to the car boot sale.
Did you eat any special foods or drink? Maybe an insect bit you. You know, like Spider-Man.
No, nothing like that. The only new thing that happened was Mum bought me some new dinosaurs and Gran bought me this old book. Oh no! I know what it is. Callum, it's the book. I know it. It's some kind of old magic book and somehow it's put a sort of spell on me.
Hang on. What do you mean a spell? What kind of old book? You didn't tell me anything about it.
I didn't think about it. Gran got in a muddle again. She bought me a book to help me with my spelling and it turned out to be about spells. Last night I read one, you know, not really meaning to. It didn't even make much sense, but I know that was it, I know. It must be what did it.
Stephen and Callum ran back to Stephen's house and straight upstairs to Stephen's room. His mum was quite surprised not to have to ask him to change out of his uniform. The boys didn't even seem interested in having a snack or watching the TV.
Here it is. Look.
It certainly looks old. The writing's all funny. How did you manage to read any of it?
I don't know. There was just this one page that seemed to make sense. Last night, it was the only one I could read, really. Now, where is it?
Was it this one? That looks like a picture of a frog.
No.
How about here? I think that word is India.
No, it's not that one either. It must have been further on. It's no good. I can't find it. Last night it seemed so clear and now it's disappeared.
Stephen! Callum! It's time for supper. Callum, I called your mum and dad to let them know that you're here, but your dad said that you had to be home by 6. Come on now, boys, please.
Let's work it out tomorrow. We can talk at break time. I reckon you should put the book somewhere safe, like treasure, and don't tell anyone, okay?
That night, Stephen lay awake in bed for ages trying to work out what had happened to him. He even looked through the book again to try and find the page that he had read the night before, but no luck. It was as if it had just disappeared. The next day at school, the boys were kept busy preparing for the end-of-term concert, the big event before the holidays. Everyone in the school had been working really hard to make sure that the concert was the best ever. Stephen and Callum's class were painting huge posters to hang on the back of the stage. They made the end of the hall look like a view into the ocean, and Callum and Stephen spent ages with silver paper making tiny little fish to stick on the sea. They spent all of break time and lunchtime puzzling over the book. Stephen teased Callum because he said he could hear Megan talking about him in the playground. But it wasn't until the short walk home from school that they had the chance to talk about it properly. And that day, the short walk home nearly got them into trouble.
Maybe you'll just be like Spider-Man, and one day we'll hear about a baddie and you'll help the police to catch him.
Will I have to have a special suit to wear?
We could make you one of those masks out of paper plates that we made with Mrs. Martin at Easter.
With the rabbit ears and the whiskers on the nose, I could be Super Bunny. Ta-da! Boing, boing, boing. Callum, hang on, I can hear something.
What is it, Super Bunny?
No, seriously. Shh. Callum, I can hear people talking. It's a group of boys. They must be in that garden behind the fence over there across the road.
So, what's the big deal with talking?
It's those boys that left to go to the big school last year. You know, Geordie's big brother, Hamface and Peter P. They're making a plan, Callum. Quick, get down. I need to listen.
Stephen and Callum crouched down behind a small bush next to the path, while Stephen listened intently to the conversation behind the fence on the other side of the road. They were there for about 10 minutes before Stephen said that he'd heard enough and it was okay for them to go.
This is serious, Cal. They're planning to mess up some stuff in the school. They're still really cross that Mr. Hall told them off in front of the whole school for damaging the football pitch. Do you remember? He even talked to all their parents.
So? That was ages ago.
I know, but they're going to try and get their own back. I heard them. Hamface was talking about getting into the school on Thursday after we've all gone home and rubbishing everything we've got ready so that the end of term concert will be spoilt.
What do you mean?
They're going to tear up all our paintings and kick the rest of the stuff around the hall so that it won't be able to be fixed in time.
We've got to do something. Thursday's the day after tomorrow. We've got to make a plan to stop them. Look, I'll run home and tell Dad that I'm coming to yours for tea, okay? That way, we'll have tonight and tomorrow to think of something.
You can't. I've got swimming.
Oh no.
Look, you go and think as hard as you can about how we can catch them. We've also got to work out how we can both get out at tea time on Thursday.
All through the swimming lesson, Stephen's mind kept wandering. He hardly noticed when the teacher shouted at him for holding his float the wrong way. Strange thing was, he didn't need it now. His super strength meant that just a few gentle kicks with his legs and he could swim the length of the pool. But he certainly didn't want anyone to know, so he spluttered and complained, just like the rest of the group. On the way home, his mum noticed that something was up.
Is something the matter, Stephen? You've seemed very quiet the last couple of days.
Nothing, Mum, I'm fine.
There's nothing troubling you at school, is there, darling? You're not worried about work, or the end-of-term concert, or anything?
No, Mum, really, I'm fine. Just looking forward to the holidays.
Stephen crossed his fingers and hoped really, really hard that his mum wouldn't know he was about to tell a whopping great fib.
Mum, is it okay if I go out with Callum after school on Thursday? Mr. Hall wants us to help make sure everything's finished ready for the concert.
Of course, dear. I'm glad you've offered to help. I'm surprised Mr. Hall didn't ask some older boys and girls, though. Your class has done so much already. I'm surprised he didn't send a note either. He usually does when you have to stay late.
He was going to, Mum, but we told him not to worry. He said he'd give us a lift home afterwards.
Okay, darling, but you absolutely must be home and in bed before 8, okay?
The next day at school seemed to last forever. Whenever they got the chance, Stephen and Callum worked on their plans for the following night. Stephen told Callum about what he had said to his mum to make sure that Callum told his parents the same story. As soon as school was over, they ran home, and when Callum had told his parents where he was off to, he ran round to Stephen's and straight up to his room.
Look, I found you this. It's part of that Action Man suit I got last Christmas, a balaclava. It hides your head and face so that no one can see who you are. There are some trousers too. They're pretty cool because they've got clips and stuff to hang tools off. And they're black, which means they're almost invisible at night.
And I found this old cape that came with my knight's outfit. And this jumper, look. Gran knitted it for me last Christmas, and I've never worn it. It's got my initials on it. SB. You know what I was thinking?
Not Super Bunny. You know that really was a joke, Stephen.
No, don't be stupid, silly. I'm Superboy. Look.
Wow, you really are. There's definitely something magic going on. It's like you've transformed. You even look stronger and smarter.
And I've got this, look, as a super kit box.
It's your lunchbox, Stephen.
I know, but it's got SB on it too. And inside I've converted it so it's got everything I need to catch the baddies. I've put in rope, chalk, the Action Man torch you gave me for my birthday.
That looks brilliant. But how exactly are we going to catch them?
The two boys kept planning right up till the moment when Callum had to go home. By then, they were both worn out, and Stephen had just enough energy left to pack his Superboy kit away before it was time for a bath and bed. After Mum had finished his story, he slipped out of bed and found the old spellbook that he had hidden in a box at the bottom of his wardrobe. He was feeling so tired, but he thought that he'd have just one last look to see if he could find that strange and mysterious spell that he'd found on Sunday night. Strangely, the book fell straight open at the page he'd tried so hard to find with Callum on Monday. Stephen fell asleep with the words spinning in his head. At the initial of the serpent and the letter like 8, four ancient powers just will not wait. Used for good only must they be, for else they'll be taken away from ye. Thursday passed quickly at school because, apart from the normal lessons, all the children and teachers spent every spare moment preparing for the concert the following afternoon. Stephen's class spent all break time and half of lunchtime finishing the decorations for the stage, and by the time the school day had ended, it looked really stunning. Class 5 had finished making the costumes that the children were wearing in the show, and they were hung up carefully behind the stage so that they would look perfect on the big day. There were even cups and plates laid out in the hall, ready for refreshments. Stephen and Callum went home to their own houses and had an early tea before heading straight back out again to help Mr. Hall finish getting ready, or so they had told their parents. In fact, they met just down the lane from the school's back gate.
"Where's all your stuff?"
"In my rucksack. I couldn't come out dressed in all the kit, could I? Come on, let's get over the gate so that we can get ready for them."
The two boys climbed the locked back gate that led into the school playground. It wasn't difficult, as they both loved climbing and would practice climbing trees whenever they had the chance. It was also still quite light, so they could see what they were doing.
"Right, let's get over to the nursery playhouse so that you can change and we can get ready for when they arrive." "Did you manage to get a phone?"
"Yeah. My sister will totally kill me. I took it from her room when she was eating her tea. I hope she'll be too interested in Coronation Street to notice it's missing. Otherwise, I'm dead. I got Mr. Hall's number and the local police number from my dad's address book last night."
"Great. It's not easy getting changed when you can't stand up. Hold the box, will you? Ouch! I can't get the balaclava on right. Ah, that's better."
"Just be sure to catch them quickly, will you? So that I can call and we can get home, right? Now, I don't know whether I'm more scared of getting rumbled by Hamface or caught by my sister with her phone."
"Shh, they're coming. I can hear them just the other side of the fence. They're climbing over in turns. Sounds like Peter P slipped and caught his legs. Look, here they come. You can see them running round the corner."
"Oh no, Stephen. They're even bigger than I remembered. You haven't got a chance. Why don't I just call for help and we can say that we were walking past and we saw them climbing the gate?"
"It's okay. I'm not me, remember? This is Superboy you're talking to. I'm 10 times stronger than all of them put together now."
"But Stephen, have you seen what they're holding?"
"Yep, I didn't think you could see those without super eyesight. Peter P's got a cricket bat and Geordie's brother's carrying a nasty looking stick." "Right, get ready to call as soon as I give you the signal. And remember, you've got to sound like an old lady, okay?"
"I'll remember. Good luck."
"Not so fast, Peter P. I could smell you a mile off. Isn't it a bit late for you to be handing in your homework?" "Oh, I see. You've come for cricket practice. Sorry, but I have to tell you that finished on Monday."
"What? Who? What are you? Get lost or I'll hit you for 6.
"Something tells me you're about to be caught out, Peter P. Mind if I take a turn in bat?" "Now I think it's time for you to hang around while the others finish play."
"What? How? Who? Ouch!"
"Yes, I think that hook up there should be just about high enough. Let's just get your smelly old collar over it. There we go. Now you know what it feels like to be hung up by someone much stronger than yourself. I hope it will teach you a lesson."
"Ugh! Get me down, you! You! You!"
"Right. One down, or should I say up? 2 to go. Now something tells me I'll find them in the hall."
Superboy left Peter P hanging by his collar from a hook high in the hall, a frustrating, uncomfortable punishment that Peter P. had inflicted many times on younger boys and girls during his time at the school. Next, he hurried to the school hall and was amazed that the two bigger boys had been able to make such a mess in such a short time. Costumes and chairs had been kicked around the room, and Geordie's brother was just about to slash the beautiful posters with the point on his stick.
Jealous of the good work, are you?
What did you say, Emmy?
Who in the world are you? Look, mate, it's Superman's baby brother. Ah, how sweet. Ah. Ah!
What the? What's going on? Who are you? Some kind of superhero, kid?
You could say that.
Look, Emmy. Bless him. He's even bought his sandwiches.
Untie me, you idiot! Watch out! He's throwing his signies at you!
Ouch! You little... That lunchbox was heavy! Give me back my stick!
Thanks. I think we'll save that for the garden bonfire, don't you? Now, if you'll excuse me...
Superboy used the rope from his lunchbox to tie the two villains back to back in the middle of the hall. They weren't going anywhere.
There, that's got things tied up nicely. Now, chaps, I'm afraid I must be off.
Let me out!
Now, there's just one final thing. Where did I put that chalk? Ah, here it is. Make the calls.
Oh, hello. Yes, officer. I was out walking my poodle and I happened to notice three quite big boys climbing over the gates to the primary school. Yes, that's right. No, just a few minutes ago. I thought you should know. My name, officer. Mrs. Goggins, from the post office. You will investigate, I trust. Thank you, officer.
Now for Mr. Hull. This one will be harder.
Oh, hello, Mr. Hull. I'm calling to let you know that I've seen some nasty-looking big boys climbing over the fence to your school. That's right. I was just walking past with my poodle. You'll come down, will you? Oh, good. Cheerio.
Phew!
What happened? Did you get them?
Yeah, it was cool. Did you call the police and Mr. Hall?
Yeah.
Great. I need to get out of this stuff.
Superboy quickly changed out of his kit and was transformed back into Stephen Burrows. He shoved everything back deep into his rucksack.
Quiet! The police are here!
I can see Mr. Hall too. He's at the bottom of the road.
The two boys kept deadly still, watching out of the window of the playhouse as the two police officers went into the school, stopping on their way to look at the broken door. They also paused, and it seemed like they were looking at some marks on the playground. It wasn't long before the police left the building again, this time leading Hamface, Peter P, and Geordie's brother into the back of their police van. One of the police officers then returned to the school entrance, where he met Mr. Hall and disappeared inside. Stephen and Callum took the chance to get out of the playhouse and dash across the playground, over the back wall, and along the lane from where they each ran quickly home.
Hi, Mum! Hi, Gran! Hi, Dom.
Hello, darling. How did it go? I didn't hear Mr. Hall's car. He did give you a lift, didn't he?
Yes, Mum. He just dropped me on the corner so that he could go straight round to Callum's.
Did you get everything finished for the concert?
Yes, Mum. It's all done.
I expect you're tired, aren't you? Why don't I make you a hot chocolate and then you can go straight up to the bath?
Thanks, Mum.
The next morning, Stephen felt quite strange going into school. He had a peep into the hall on his way past, and everything looked fine. Mr. Hall must have put the stuff back where it belonged last night. In the playground, all the children could talk about was what had happened the previous evening. The rumours were that some vandals had smashed their way into the school and some new kind of superhero had flown in to beat them.
Georgie said that he had a cape and a mask and amazing superpowers.
I heard he was as strong as 10 grown-ups and had a magic rope to catch things, a bit like Spider-Man's, but it wasn't sticky.
He's called Superboy, and he left a sign. I heard Mr. Hall talking about it. The caretakers covered it up with a doormat, but we're going to sneak out and have a look underneath.
Mr. Hall got the whole school together in the hall before lunch for a special mini-assembly to talk about what had gone on the previous night.
As I'm sure you've already heard, there was an incident at the school last night which could have spelt the end of all our hard work for the school concert. 3 vandals broke into the school and did their best to destroy everything that you see around you now. Fortunately, and somewhat strangely, someone followed them into the school and put a stop to their vandalism. This person, who remains unknown to us at the school and the police, disappeared before either myself or the police could thank him. Our only clues as to his identity come from what the vandals themselves could tell us. Oh, and the initials SB that were left behind. I've heard a lot of talk about Superboy in the playground this morning, and I only ask that you keep your imaginations under control. The chances are that SB was just a very kind and brave member of the public who happened to be passing the school at the right time. Our job now is to get on with our work in order to ensure that this afternoon's end-of-term concert is the best ever. Now, please get on with your lunches.
Stephen and Callum looked at each other and didn't know whether to laugh or hide. They couldn't quite believe that they got away without being seen. Stephen was holding his lunchbox tightly under his arm, trying to cover the initials SB so that they didn't attract any attention.
I can't believe no one saw us.
Me neither. You must have been brilliant on the phone. What happened with your sister, by the way?
Oh, she was furious. She'd noticed the phone was missing and started screaming at me the moment I got in. Luckily, Mum and Dad heard. I told them that I'd only taken it because I was worried about being out late and had been too shy to ask. They took my side, and luckily, Caroline's shouting stopped them asking too many questions about what I'd been up to.
What an adventure!
What does Superboy do next, do you think?
I think he comes out where and when he's needed, don't you?
Yeah, and I think in the meantime, he should spend some time practicing his signature. Those chalk marks look pathetic.
Oi, Mrs. Goggins, I'll get you for that.
Stephen Burrow, Superboy, smartest kid in the neighbourhood. Stephen Burrow, Superboy, uses his magic powers for good. Super eyes, super ears, super nose. Whenever there's trouble, Stephen knows. Stephen Burrow, Stephen Burrow, super.